We have been systematically going through instruments of the orchestra and talking about various repetitive strain injuries that can happen from these instruments. And today, Dr. Markison is going to teach us about the clarinet. So welcome back to the show, Dr. Markison. What can you tell us about clarinets?
Well, thank you. I'm a lifelong clarinetist, and here's my little baby. We rock the baby. And so the heart and soul of a clarinet is not so much the mouthpiece as the barrel, B-A-R-R-E-L. And I do make my own barrels, lathe turning them. And some of the recipe came from Anthony Gigliotti, the principal clarinetist of the Philadelphia Symphony. And so using that geometry, changing it, you have much more depth of tone, and it's really kind of wonderful. But I turn it from the same African blackwood as the rest of the clarinet is turned. Any case, in a noisy world that we have in or out of a pandemic and in and out of political fracas, my concept of playing music is to listen 90%, play 10%, and absorb it. And then when you play, play for 5 minutes, self-record it, play it back, cycles of action and repose so that you can really listen to it, archiving it every 3 to 6 months for 10, 15 minutes. But doing your dailies where you self-record, again, 5 minutes play, 5 minutes listen. But always play in a soft dynamic range. In a noisy world, that seems like anathema, but it's never failed me. I like people to lean in and say, what is that? Because the whisper is intimate and the shout is not. What happens to clarinetists? Well, it depends on the anatomy. You know, anatomy is destiny. And so within 5 or 6 weeks of intrauterine life, you start to get your flexor tendons going and extensor tendons and the things that wiggle your digits. And so the threshold moment for me was when I realized that I didn't have an independent flexor system for my right dominant little finger. Therefore, the keys here were a challenge to get this guy to be independent when he's congenitally linked to his neighbor, the ring. And about, I'm in the case of 8 to 10% of people who don't even have what's called the superficial flexor. Whereas on the other hand, this is what truth and beauty is all about. And so I have non-symmetrical hands with complete independence of the little finger on the left, which activates these little keys, compared with the right that has to do a four-key cluster. And so what I've done over time, starting in my adolescent years, learning machining and casting of metals, was to scale these down by about, initially 25%, subsequently 10, currently 5 to 10% smaller keys so that I don't exploit the interdependent little finger away from the ring finger, assigning it too much. I keep it close and I keep its travel small. So that means that I can do more things quickly. So that makes life better. So I don't want to strain myself. So if you have fingers that may not be symmetrical and certainly may not have independence of the little finger, you can solve it by a little cleverness and instrument redesign. Now the clarinet rests on the right thumb. Whoa, it rests on the thumb. Now obviously you can take some of the weight on your other thumb, but you have to activate a little register key that moves you up a musical 12th with that one. So a lot of it, and somewhat balance point, is here. So the way you do a thumb rest, this is not adjustable, but you can get adjustable thumb rests, which can be great. Because let me remind you, the truth and beauty of our fabulous opposable thumb comes at a cost. The cost is instability for the purpose of opposability. You have intrinsic instability. There are 9 vectors of force, including the muscle wad and tendons coming from forearm, that activate this. So not only is it intrinsically unstable with aging and time, we can have weakening of the thumb index intermetacarpal ligament complex. And then it gets even worse because the bearing surfaces of the joint, the cartilage, get worn out. So I'd say a few times a month, I'll have to reconstruct the thumb joints of clarinetists who have had wear and tear arthritis. And it takes a few months to recover, but my 40 years of follow-up have been wonderful with my worldwide menagerie of musicians who've worn out their thumbs supporting posts of woodwinds, not just clarinets, oboes, English horns, alto clarinets, bass clarinets. Barry sax, alto sax, tenor sax, soprano sax, all of these thumb-posted instruments. Now you can use a neck strap and you can take some of the weight off, but a lot of people don't want this around their neck. You can use a chest harness. That can help take some of the weight. It's a little cumbersome if you're really literally moving around on stage or in performance, but those are ways to take the pressure off. Now, what else happens? Well, one of the conditions of the aging hand is called Dupuytrans. Dupuytrans is fibrous contracture of the normally present fibrous matrix of tissue that three-dimensionally holds your skin in place. You realize that this has to be tethered skin so that you can reliably pinch and pick up objects. And so this skin on the top is loose. It just keeps the rain out, really, as far as I can think. But this has to be tethered. Now, if you have misbehavior of the fibrous matrix called palmar aponeurosis, this can draw down what Dupuytrans described in the early to mid 19th century was fibrous contracture, initially nodules, and then it can draw you down. If it draws you down, you may be in a fixed position, which makes it very cumbersome to operate anything if you're kind of pulled down. And so that's Dupuytrans contractures. It's largely genetic. There are two types. One is probably post-traumatic and the other is genetic. And the ancestry rank order, worst to least, is Scandinavia, British Isles, Western Europe, Mediterranean, in terms of prevalence. So somewhere in the family tree, skipping generations, one woman for every man, every 10 men, you can get those contractures, maybe symmetrical, maybe not. May initially involve knuckle joints, MCPs, could involve PIP joints. Simple treatment is stretching. If it gets worse and worse, there are other treatment options we don't need to go into. Suffice to say, although it's somewhat correctable, there's a recurrence rate after the best surgical treatment of 30%+. So patients need to know it may not be a long-term cure. I've been lucky, but it doesn't mean I'm better than anyone else at surgical treatment of these things. Next thing that happens is trigger fingers, where you can get a sticking finger that kind of clicks and you wake up in the morning, your primary care doc says it's arthritis. It's not arthritis, it's just a tendon that's a little bit tight. And so that means you have a pulley system that holds the tendons against the skeleton for reliable motion. And the first of a series of five rings can get tight. Callus on either side of that ring means click, 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 as the tendon moves through a 1-inch excursion travel. And so that's easy to do. Sometimes cortisone injections once or twice will do it, 40 to 70% of the time. In diabetics, 20 to 40% of the time, that'll do it and take care of it and cure it. But otherwise, you just make a tiny incision. I just release these using ultrasound guidance, working through natural creases, quick recovery, triggered single or multiple trigger digit releases. Now, the other thing that can happen, apropos this thumb as a post business, is strain of the tendons here in the first of six tunnels, six compartments on the top of the wrist. And that's called de Quervain's stenosing tenosynovitis, cumbersome term. What Fritz de Quervain's described was this little band over top of the tendons can get tight and swollen and painful. And so every move that goes across the hand can cause pain. And that's responsive usually to a little rest, perhaps physical hand therapy, sometimes little steroid injections. I ultrasonographically examine all these patients to see if they have anatomical variation that mitigates against a non-surgical remedy. If they, for example, have a double-barreled first extensor compartment, 60% of patients undergoing surgery do have that. It pushes me towards trying non-surgical remedies, but otherwise making a tiny incision and releasing that little tight band and curing the problem for good. De Quervain's stenosing tenosynovitis. The other things that happen apart from thumb wear and tear arthritis, which I should mention is obviously reconstructable with some downtime, trigger digits, Dupuytrans contractures, and de Quervain's are other forms of tendonitis, little flexor tenosynovitis, inflammation of the tendons gliding here, one per digit, flexor, superficial flexor tenosynovitis, burning pain, radiating proximally, extensor tendonitis or tenosynovitis. As you go, as the tendons travel, they're little tenosynovial tunnels. And that can be a problem. Obviously, a flamenco guitarist, for example, doing rasgueado, this brisk thing with their left hand, or I'm sorry, with the right hand, they end up with some tendonitis through here. And again, this is treatable. Rest, hand therapy, contrast baths, rare anti-inflammatories, some dietary changes, and so on. Playing softly, and I cannot overemphasize the idea of playing piano, pianissimo, occasionally mezzo forte for emphasis, but practice should be in a whisper so that you're barely able to hear what you're doing. And then you've really got the combination of intonation and nuance. So that's a handful of things clarinetists suffer. They're treatable problems.
Yes, I was watching a video that was interviewing a famed clarinetist, Ralph Johnson, and he was complaining about shoulder fatigue, shoulder pain, and talking about the importance of not smoking and diet and cardiovascular exercise and that sort of thing. And I'm just so happy that there's a lot of places have no smoking rules, because that would be really anathema for anyone who cares about their lung health to be forced to play in a smoke-filled nightclub.
Yeah, I agree with that. And so it's neck, thorax. You're always thinking comprehensively from brain to fingertips. But what I omitted there is common things, carpal tunnel syndrome with loss of sensibility, thumb index, middle half of ring, causing inaccurate use of the keys. Cubital tunnel, entrapment of the ulnar nerve, which is going to go down and serve 15 out of 20 small muscles. So you'll have dexterity problems, numbness and tingling in little and outer half of ring. Ulnar tunnel can give you similar problems, 2 points of entrapment of the ulnar nerve, not only carpal tunnel, but potential near side, meaning proximal entrapments of the median nerve, like median strip down a highway right through the tunnel. The radial tunnel, which goes here, can rarely, but sometimes be trapped. And I've had clarinetists in whom I've had to do little radial tunnel releases over a short distance from there all the way into there, because they have weakness of thumb, index, proper extensor, little finger proper, and common extensors. Rarely a dropped wrist, but sometimes after a fracture of the humerus. And this is a disaster, obviously, for anybody playing instruments. But if they cannot position, because that the radial nerve operates the positioners, which are fast and weak. The median and ulnar operate the curlers and the intrinsics, which are strong and slower. But the entrapment neuropathies obviously are included among wind players, vertical inline wind players, flute players who are twisted around and have a whole new array of problems.
One thing that occurred to me when you were talking about the adaptation you did on your own clarinet, is it possible, is it common knowledge among musicians that they can adapt certain instruments to fit their hands? And where would they go for that sort of thing?
Well, they probably go to an instrument repair person who has plenty of experience and is willing to experiment. I was very blessed because my dad was in charge of a machine shop in World War II and a battleship repair ship off Okinawa. So running the machine shop, he learned all the machine skills, casting, turning, machining metals, and taught me all those things. So I took the law and my instruments in my own hands, but was encouraged by others, people who I'd studied with, who I shared this anatomical variation with, and they said, just go for it. I mean, anybody can take a low melt magnesium alloy or pewter, make a little mold, cast it, play with it, do some things themselves, but better to have a certified musical instrument repair person as a starter. And if they say no, fine. It just depends whether you're going to get some junk clarinets and start cutting things up and bending things around. For me, it's nothing. It's the same way. This is a handmade recorder, a Sopranino recorder. And I basically took the internal measurements, did some low melt magnesium alloy casting to get the internal measurements to have some tapers done, because this is a conical section from here to here called a frustum geometrically, then make up my own fingering system so I could do anything I want. So for me, you know, marking my own sonic territory by defining my own fingering system that plays in tune, but is loose enough for jazz, tight enough for classical. That was basically my little adventure in wood, but it's fine. So I encourage anybody to take apart anything, get a piece of junk, plug it up, make some mistakes, record your stumbles, and get shreds of success.
Yeah, thank you for saying that. I think it's so important for people to have customized, it fits you. You're not straining to fit it.
Well, sure. You remember the two tenets of industrial design that universally apply to all human activated things. One, choice. Two, adjustability. If you have both, fabulous. If you don't have either, somebody made a mistake at the design level.
I would add to that, form follows function. I think that's exactly. From a different school of thought, but you know, you kind of can't go wrong.
No, I agree. As a hand surgeon, my credo is to always consider form, function, fit, and failure avoidance.
Yes. So on that note, let's all avoid all of those things. Thank you, Dr. Markison.
Keep it musical. Thank you.